Well, good morning, everyone. How are you all doing today?
Good
to see those of you who are in the sanctuary ready for our time of worship and celebration and song. We're going to be singing about our Lord. We're going to be singing to our Lord. His name is Jesus. Come on, won't you stand to your feet and join us as we bless him today. It says that there's joy in the house of the Lord.
You ready, Megan?
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. Our God still holds the victory. Come on, say it. Gonna shout out his praise.
Come y'all sing out loud and sing.
We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Cause he hung upon that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God, still a rolling stones away. Hey, yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. Shout out his praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. Shout out his praise.
My favorite part says,
we were the beggars, now we're royalty. Accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Come on, y'all, sing it out. Say,
we were the beggars, now we're royalty. And we were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Of worship, God. God is so good to us. I want to welcome everyone here. I also want to welcome people at home who are watching live and those who are watching a recording later. If this is your first time with us, I want to welcome you as a guest in our home. We have refreshments in the lobby that we'd love for you to enjoy. Please connect with Robin at the Connections table. We would love to personally greet you and get to know you while you're here and before you leave. Please take a couple minutes to say hello to the people around you and feel free to get up and greet someone across the room.
Just wants to keep my mind.
I do. It's a good mic. I think it makes me louder. Really, I just want to be Oliver.
Let's try.
All right. If it is your first time here, we do have blue connection cards. This allows us to reach out to you in between the week and just see how you're doing to pray for you. And so if you would get one of those blue cards in your pamphlet, fill it out and put it in the white box in the back. And Bill is in his second week of his series, Follow Me. And so before we jump into that, just like the song said, you know, we were beggars and now we are royalty.
Yes.
We were prisoners, but now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, and redeemed by His grace. Please pray with me. Lord God, Your gifts to us are just abundant, Lord. We are thankful for God, all that You have done for us, how You have saved us from the wicked that we are, Lord. And that You have made us righteous so that we can have our relationship with You.
Yes.
God, that we can be with You for all eternity through the sacrifice of Jesus. And Lord, we want to take today and give it back to You, Lord God, and praise You for all that You have done for us. God, thank You for the people here in this church and how they have sacrificed their talents to lead us, Lord God. Thank You for the hours and the diligence that have gone into the sermon today, in the practice and the talents for leading worship from Oliver and Megan, God. Thank You, Lord, for the people of this body and just the direction that You have our church going. Lord, we know that You are here. You are surely in this place. And God, thank You for Your presence. Lead us today, God, to give it all back to You, to set it at Your feet, because Lord, You deserve it all. You deserve all the worship. We praise You, Lord God. Amen.
Amen.
Because our God is with us, we don't have anything to fear. Says, whom shall I fear? Nobody. Say with me.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, though troubles linger still, who shall I fear? Say, I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies, He's always by my side. The one who reigns forever, He is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies, He's always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me. Yours is the victory.
Sin runs deep, Lord, your grace is more. For grace is found, is where you are.
my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and say, Lord, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. Oh, my one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God.
Lord, I need you.
Lord, I need you.
Oh, I need you.
Every hour
I need you.
My
one defense,
my
righteousness,
oh
God, I need you.
My one defense.
Thank you for this morning, and we want to continue to worship Jesus. We want to worship through the Word of God this morning, and I pray that that your Word would accomplish the purposes that it was sent forth this morning, God, and I pray that I'd get out of the way, that you would just speak through me, Father. May I just be a mouthpiece for you this morning. May your Word come alive, Lord. May you encourage us, challenge us, lead us, comfort us. Lord Jesus, may you be glorified, and we all pray us all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You guys can go ahead and be seated. It's great to see everybody here this morning. It's a bright and sunny day. So those of you that are visiting for the first time, my name is Bill, and we are very glad that you're here, and pray that you are feel at home and enjoy the service. Jessica mentioned this, we'll mention it at the end of the service, but right outside this door, there's a table out there called a connections table. And if you are visiting with us for the first time, be sure to go by that table. A lady named Robin is going to be there, and we have a gift for you. So we're just excited that you're here with us this morning, and pray and hope that that you enjoy the service. 1980, the U.S. hockey team played Russia in the Olympics. Just before the game, it was not the gold medal game, but it was a medal round, just before the, to play for the gold medal. Just before the game, Coach Herb Brooks is speaking to the United States team, and they're playing this incredible opponent, this giant of a team, the Russians. And in this speech to his team in the locker room that day, he said, "Great moments are born out of great opportunities." Great moments are born out of great opportunities. What a great line. What a great line. What opportunities do you have today? What opportunities are you faced with? Are you in the middle of today? Great moments are born out of great opportunities. I recently saw a movie called Air. How many of you guys seen the movie Air about the story of Michael Jordan and Nike? Three people. Okay, so a few people. So let me give you a refresher course here. So 1984, the NBA draft comes out. Michael Jordan, I'm going to go with the assumption that everybody knows who that is. Michael Jordan, NBA basketball player, you can Google him. So incredible, iconic basketball player, one of the greatest basketball players of all time, has come out. He's been drafted in the NBA, which is only he's actually the third draft pick in the 84 draft. Number one was one and only Hakeem Olajuwon that year, Houston Rockets. But he's the third player in the draft. Now, he's not Jordan yet. Yeah, so we know him as Michael Jordan and Air Jordan, right? But people know him, they're familiar with him, but he's not just this iconic figure. He hadn't played a game of professional basketball yet, okay? Hadn't played in the NBA yet. But one of the things that these sneaker companies do is they try to, when these players get drafted, they're like, hey, let's get a contract with this guy so they can market our shoe so that we can make some money and we'll pay them a little bit of money. But, you know, hopefully we can get some good players so that people want to buy their shoes because they're a good player and then maybe they think that they're a player, all that kind of stuff. Well, at this particular time, Nike wasn't Nike as it is today either. So Jordan's not Jordan. Nike's not Nike. So Nike was primarily a running shoe at this time. They had some people in the NBA that wore Nike shoes, but they only had 17% market share in the NBA, which meant that there was, out of all the NBA players that wore different brands of shoes, 17% of them wore Nikes. That's why they had 17% market share, because 17%, 5.5 years of college. So you come up here and close this, we're just going to land on that, you know? And so they were a small fish in a big pond. Converse was number one, Adidas is number two. So, you know, at least as the movie goes, they had a certain amount of money. They're like, well, we're going to have to spread over about three or four players that we can get maybe a contract with, and they're not going to be one of the top players in the draft, but we're going to try to get somebody. But Nike had this guy that worked at their company called Sonny Vaccaro. Sonny Vaccaro was a guy who was basically getting the deal set with these athletes in these shoes. And he believed so much in Michael Jordan. And he saw something that even back then people didn't even see what he became today. And so he convinced Nike to put all their chips on the table and to sign a contract, a huge contract, which was bigger than what they really could do at that time, for this guy, Michael Jordan. And, you know, the movie goes, the struggle. The other thing about it was that Michael Jordan didn't want to sign with Nike. That's a little challenging, right? So Sonny's a wise guy. So what does he do? He calls his mom. It's a true story. And he gets his mom and convinced mom, and the story goes, in case you didn't know, but Jordan goes to Nike and they signed the deal. But it was a huge deal. It was a huge contract. And actually, they ended up giving Michael Jordan a percentage of the sale of all the shoes. Okay, so he's making a whole lot of money. He has not played a game yet in the NBA. And like his mom says in the movie, and she actually, I think she said this in real life, she said, you know, the shoe's just a shoe until my son steps into it. So kind of in honor of that, I called Steve this morning. I said, I need some Air Jordans. He's got a few of them, and so he brought these up here. So I don't have a basketball with me. I don't have a goal, but be like Mike, right? It's a great movie, though, because it's really about opportunity and about taking a risk. The thing is, we are faced with opportunities all along. And if you look back now, you're like, oh, man, that was great. You know, there was a lot on the table with this opportunity. They didn't know what was going to happen. And one of the challenges for us is that when we have opportunities presented to us, is that we often want to know what the outcome is going to be, right? We want to go, let me evaluate it, let me Google it, let me do a spreadsheet or whatever it is. Like you're just going to just analyze this thing. It's like, I want to make sure that if I'm going to step out in this opportunity, I'm willing to take a risk as long as there's a benefit, there's a payout for me on the other side. We often want to know what is going to be the benefit of this opportunity before me. So you might be presented even today, you might be in the middle of a business deal, a job opportunity, you got an opportunity to buy a stock at the right time, you got an opportunity to sell a stock at the right time, you might be interested in a girl, or a girl might be interested in you, or a guy interested in you, or whatever, and you're like, man, the opportunity's right there, you know, I don't want to miss it. You know, we're all filled with these different opportunities that are before us. Oftentimes, sometimes we don't take that step because we just don't know what's going to happen, right? But the other thing is that I think that one of the ways that we miss opportunities is we don't even realize that it's an opportunity. See, life comes in different shapes, sizes, and forms. And life often comes to us, opportunities come to us sometimes in disguise. And we don't see it. And when we miss that opportunity, we got 20/20 vision, right? You can, you know, Converse can look back and know and say, we blew that deal, right, with Jordan. We should have gone there, but nobody really knew. But when opportunity comes in disguise, we often miss it and we don't see it. And what I want to talk to us this morning is about the disguise of opportunity in our life right now. And you might be experiencing right now. And the disguise is this, is the opportunity of adversity. The opportunity of adversity. Someone's like, I'm out of here, man. I don't want to hear that message, right? The opportunity of adversity. But when you and I are faced with adversity, it is an opportunity. We spend most of our life trying to avoid adversity, trying to walk around adversity. But if you hear anything this morning, hear this, that God wants you to walk right through the adversity in your life. Right through it. See, one of the things about Jordan at the end of the movie, Sunshine, we were on a date watching it. It was awesome. So we're at the end of the movie, spoiler alert, but at the credits, they go on and they start kind of playing some clips of Michael Jordan. You've seen the commercial. It's a Gatorade commercial, okay? But it's like everybody wants to be like Mike, right? You know, and so you got these little kids, you know, out playing basketball, and it's like, you know, sometimes I dream he's me, you know, whatever. I don't know if you've ever been in a basketball court and you're in there in your driveway trying to dunk a ball. I think it was like 8th, 9th grade one time, I was in my driveway and I was dunking, like doing 360s. I had lowered the goal to a little bit. So just a little bit. It was an old goal. Remember, I just slammed it and I came down with a rim in my hand. And I thought, nobody's going to believe this. I was like, this is just incredible, right? So, but, you know, all these people, like, they're trying to be like Michael Jordan. And if you followed along last week with this, is that the idea of becoming a follower of Jesus isn't just to learn about Jesus, to know about Jesus, is but to actually become like Jesus, to be like him. And one of the tools and the ways that Jesus, that God will work in our life to shape us, to become like him, to do things that he did, to have the character that he had, to be about the purpose that he had, to have the heart that he had, is to bring adversity in our life. So we're going to take a look at this morning at a story of some followers of Jesus who experienced some adversity. If you were with us last week, we talked about this guy, Matthew. Matthew was a former tax collector, a guy far from God, who Jesus just called him, and he called him to become like him. Matthew follows him. He's there, like, following him for 3 years. He's in his inner circle, which is called the 12 disciples. Jesus dies, is resurrected. Matthew sees the resurrected Jesus and spent the rest of his life following Jesus till the very end of his death. And he wrote a letter, a biography on Jesus. We call it the Gospel of Matthew. There's a couple other people that wrote a biography on Jesus as well. And his, along with some other people, after years of it being circulated and being considered to be authoritative and Word of God, it all got put together in a book we call the Bible. So we're going to take a look at that letter again, written by Matthew. And in this story, Matthew is kind of an observer, so to speak. I mean, he's in the middle of the story, but he really highlights something. One of the disciples in the midst of this adversity that they're facing. But what we're going to see in this story is this. We're going to see three anchors in this story that they learn, that hopefully you and I can learn, that we can have these three anchors when you and I are in the winds of adversity. Three anchors, okay? So let's just go ahead and open up. If you have a Bible, it's the first book in the New Testament, Matthew. It's going to come up on our screen. And, of course, you can, on your iPhone, there's a Bible app you can get on there and follow along as well. So it's funny, I used to do youth ministry when phones first came out, you know, I'd always be like, get off your phone. You know, now it's like, everybody pull out your phone to get on the Bible. So, okay, so Matthew chapter 14, verses 22-23. Again, we're talking about the opportunity of adversity, and we're talking about three anchors for us to have in the midst of adversity in our life. I'm going to read this whole story, and then we're going to go back and look at these different anchors. So, verse 22. Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. The reason why it says immediately, by the way, what is going on is he had just fed 5,000 people. Hello? You got a little bit of fish, a little bit of bread, and you feed 5,000. It's like this unbelievable miracle. You know, if you grew up in church, you went to your 5 vacation Bible schools in the summer, like you just learned all about this story, right? Well, that had just happened. And immediately as that happened, they're like celebrating, like, right, high fives, you know, they got t-shirts, you know, they got a website they're creating, you know, like follow us on Twitter, you know, making sure everybody's got their handle, whatever. And Jesus is like, boys, come on, let's go. Let's go. So it says he dismissed dismissed the crowds, and it says in verse 23, and after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by but the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. Hello? But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand, took hold of him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The first anchor this morning we find in this story, when you're in the winds of adversity, is this, is that God sends you in the storm on purpose for a purpose. God will send you in a storm on purpose for a purpose. Listen, Jesus sent him in the storm. Now, there's different storms in the Bible. There's a storm of correction. Not saying Jesus sent you into that one, okay? Sometimes we're in the storm of correction. We're like, "Oh, man, the enemy's after me. Pray for me. Electric company turned off my light bill. The enemy's trying to bring me down. You need to pray for me." You're like, "Well, have you paid your light bill?" "No." "Well, I am praying for you because the enemy's working and you is deceiving you. You think you can't pay your light bill and continue to have your lights on." So I'm just saying some trials, adversity in our life are self-inflicted. Amen? Yeah. I got too many of those. But so we got some storms of correction, but we got some storms of perfection. These are things that are completely out of your control that God has sends you in to do something in your life, to shape you, to conform you, to prepare you for something that he has for you. So, this story was actually recorded in two other guys, John, and it was another follower of Jesus, and a guy, Mark, who a lot of people believe wrote for Peter, another follower of Jesus. They both record this story, but Matthew highlights Peter in the story, which the other two don't. But when you look at these three different stories, you saw this, that there was a reason why he sent them into the storm. It says, in John, he says that all the people wanted to make Jesus king at that moment. They're looking for a political king, right? And Jesus is like, "Hey, I got to go die, rise again. Not ready for that, and I'm not here to be a political king." And he doesn't want his disciples getting all caught up in that. So he gets them out of the way, right? He's going to get them out of the way. He's going to get them back into the private. But Mark tells us this, that even after the loaves of fish, the loaves and of bread and the fish, that they had a hard heart. See, Jesus sees what we don't see, and he sees that the heart's still hard. And he's like, "We got some growing to do. Go get in the boat." And you're like, "Wait a minute. Can we celebrate what just happened?" And Jesus said, "Come on, go get in the boat. There, I've got a training exercise for you. Come on." He's got a training exercise for him. Now, let me tell you something. When you read the Gospels, we found out this is not the disciples' first storm. Somebody turn around to somebody and say, "I've been through more than one storm." But listen, this is not their first storm. Okay, the first storm recorded that they went through, they're in the sea, the waves are crashing against the boat, they think they're going to die. I mean, I'm telling you, a couple of these guys are fishermen, not all of them were fishermen, because one of them's a tax collector, Matthew, but they're all freaking out, they're tripping out, they're wigging out, they think that we're all going down. You ever felt like that in life? You're like, "We're going down, we're sinking, it's over." And Jesus is in the boat. And like, "Jesus, come on, wake up. Don't you see what's going on? Don't you care for us? Come on, man, you've been there. Man, God, don't you care?" And Jesus steps up and, when I get to heaven, I want to see so much. I don't know about you. I'm like, can I see that story? And the whole part in the Red Sea, I want to see it. Can we do it? I mean, I don't know if there's going to be a movie day. I don't know, but I mean, I can't wait to see all this stuff, right? So Jesus calms the waves. Calms the storm, and they look at him and they go, "Who is this man that the waves even obey him?" You see, they start getting a clearer picture of Jesus, but it's not real totally in focus yet. But Jesus isn't going to send them into this storm, and he ain't going with them. And they're going to get a chance to see Jesus in a way they never saw him before. Right? So he sends them in this storm. He's going to take their faith to the next level. Again, he sees what's going on in their heart. This is very intentional. I'm going to go on with the story. Verse 23, it says that, let me go back up here. And it says, after he dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was with him. I mean, by this time, it was a long way off from the land. Okay, so on the other account, Mark and John's account, we know this. It's about 3-4 miles off of the land. That's how far the boat was in the sea. Okay, so they're about like in the middle of the ocean. They've been going at this thing for about like 8 hours. And actually says in, I think, John's account, that Jesus sees them from the shore. Now, Jesus isn't up there going, would you look at that? Look at those guys. They're just straining. Should I go get them? Nah, I'm going to go get them. I'm going to wait a little bit, you know? Nah, I'm just going to wait back. You ever feel like that? You know, maybe like Jesus is waiting. But he's got a purpose. He's got something in mind. And it says that they're stranded against the waves. And this, again, think about this. This is a very difficult situation. They're experiencing opposition, adversity. They've been going at this for all night. They're tired. They're exhausted. Waiting. When are we going to get there? Maybe gotten off a little bit off course, but they're just going and they're just trying. You ever feel like that? You ever feel like kind of overwhelmed? You're like, I'm doing what God has told me to do, but I just feel overwhelmed. I don't feel like I'm getting anywhere. I'm not really sure what's going on. I'm not sure if anybody around me's got the oar and they're trying to go with me. But this is unbelievable, this opposition, this adversity. Is this really what I signed up for? Great amount of opposition. Adversity, challenge. And it says that Jesus hasn't come to them until the fourth night. Fourth watch of the night. Fourth watch of the night, the Jewish people divided the night up into, it starts at 6 p.m., so it's divided into four sections. So you have 3 hours per four sections. Okay, so we're for the fourth watch of the night, all right? So I guess you have 3, 3, 3, and 3. Okay, so the fourth watch of the night is actually going to be about 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. That's what time this was. You ever been at 3 a.m. before? Where are you, God? Wondering if he's going to come at that time. And he comes at the last watch of the night. Sometimes, you know, you ever been in that moment where you're hanging on, it's like, don't let go. Jesus is going to show up. He sees you, and he shows up. Don't let go. We often don't know when he'll show up and what will happen, but I'm telling you, Jesus is going to show up. But he has a purpose in mind, so he shows up at the fourth watch of the night. And he shows up walking on water. You know, I don't know if you think like, is this a little dramatic? You know, like why couldn't have, like, we been on the boat one day and just the sun is shining and we're out getting some sun and, you know, eating some grapes, doing some gainers off the boat, and Jesus, like, check this out, you know? And he's walking on water. Like, that's unbelievable. Why is Jesus showing up in the midst of the adversity in this way? He's got their attention. And he's going to show up in a way that they never, ever have seen him before. They get scared. I want to make sure I point out here, this is the second storm that they're in. The first storm, they're scared of the storm. Listen, they are not scared of the storm. Neither of the story in John, Mark, or this one say that they were scared of the storm. They were the first one, but this one, they're not scared of the storm. They're scared of Jesus. You see, the sea was kind of a reflection of, they believed that it was the gateway to the abyss, and there was even a belief system that people could, even ghosts could come up from the sea and walk out on the sea. So there's this kind of mindset, and so they are in an environment that can generate some fear, because they do see that Jesus commanded the waves, but he's not with them. And so they are alone out there, but they're still wondering, like, about this sea, the power of the sea. And then they see someone that they think is a ghost, and they're terrified. But Jesus shows up. I'm going to give you a couple things about this. Jesus is taking them to their deepest fear. Listen, when you follow Jesus, he will take you to face your fear. He will take you to face your fear. What are you afraid of right now? Second thing you see in here is that they get a chance to see Jesus in a way that they never have. He's revealing his deity. When he says, "Take heart, it is I." In the original language, when he says, "It is I," he's saying it's equivalent to when God showed up to Moses and says, "I am what I am." He's saying, "I'm God." He's showing them that I'm God. And whatever your adversity is, whatever your problems right now, I'm walking on top of it. I'm God. God wants you to know that God loves you and I, and pursues you and I, and wants you to know that he's God, that Jesus is the Son of God. And that whatever problems that we're facing, that they're not greater than God, they're not bigger than God. This is God walking on water. And you can know at the end of the story when Jesus gets back in the boat and they worship and say, truly this is what? The Son of God. They got a chance to experience God in a way they hadn't experienced before, even from the first storm. So not only that, but Jesus is comforting them with his word. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. I mean, you ever need to hear a word from God sometimes? Like, God, just speak to me. Just, I want to hear from you in this moment. It's challenging. And God, he just often will comfort you, and not necessarily, he'll calm you, but he won't calm the storm. But he will calm you with his word. Do not be afraid. This is an incredible experience. Now, I'm gonna take this. I pray you to see this in fresh eyes this morning, because I don't want us to look at this as just this experience of this going through the storm and then Peter walking on water and everything. Because if you fast forward about, I don't know, maybe a year, I don't know the timeline, a year, maybe 2 years, I'm not really sure. Jesus has been crucified. He's been resurrected. The Holy Spirit has come down. The birth of the church has happened. Peter's preached his first sermon. And it says that the church has gotten to, here, check this out, about 5,000 people. He just fed 5,000 people. And it says in the text in Acts, as soon as the church got 5,000 people, they start facing adversity. Look at this text in Acts 4. It says this: "And as they were speaking, Peter and the disciples, to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them." These are the people that crucified Christ. "Greatly annoyed, because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and that number of the men came to about 5,000. You don't think that Jesus knew this was going to happen when he sent him in the storm? You don't think that he knew that these men were going to have character that could withstand great adversity and persecution? That he knew that these guys were not going to have to get caught up in the whole popularity and the thing of following Jesus, that they needed to have a deep faith? See, Jesus knows what's happening. He's training them. He's discipling them. And when God sends you through adversity, God has something for you. God has an assignment. When you and I can go through adversity and see that there is purpose in our pain, that God has a great purpose in it. God's trying to do something in their life. He wants them to have a deep, mature faith, not a shallow faith. He knows what they're going to face. God knows where he's going to take you next. God knows what he wants to do in your life. God knows what adversity you're going to, even in this moment, he's wanting to prepare you to be able to stand in that moment and to be just like him. To be just like him. It makes me look at this story in such a whole different way. Like, wow, man, Jesus was really discipling these guys. And he'll disciple you and I in the face of adversity. Let me give this scripture to you. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort that the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." You know, Paul's telling us in there, he's like, listen, I know that the affliction, the adversity, the things that I'm dealing with in my life, that God is using this in my life so that when I receive the comfort, that I can then be a vessel and begin to comfort other people. That's a whole different way to see the adversity in our life. This is on purpose for a purpose. And some of you in here could come up and share stories, amazing stories of the comfort of God, of how God has comforted you and been with you and met you in those deep and dark places. You know, the movie Dead Poets Society, actually never saw it, but I've certain clips of it, but in the movie, like, I think the guy, the teacher, Robin Williams, like, they're looking at these old, the people that were there, they're no longer there, and he's looking at him. He's like, you know what the voice, what they could just tell, they'd say, what is it, carpe diem? He says, just seize the day. Just seize the day. And listen, I pray and hope that we be a body of believers, that we be a church where our stories don't just stay on the bookshelf, but they're read with one another. God has not sent you through your adversity for you. He sent it for other people. And sometimes we get like, I'm not going to say anything. Listen, people need to hear your story. They need to hear your story. They need to hear about you walking on water. So not only is the first anchor, it's a big anchor. The first anchor is that God will send us into storms on purpose, for a purpose. Let me give you two last anchors here. We'll go back in verse 28. Check this out. "And Peter answered him, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come out to you on the water.' He said, 'Come.' So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus." You imagine the disciples in the boat saying, "Have you lost your mind? We're in the middle of a storm right now. What are you doing? Get back in the boat." Right? When was the last time you stepped out in faith and people thought you lost your mind? What is Peter doing? Peter, great, we're not afraid anymore. Jesus is here. Great, it's still like, still raging sea here. We're still going. And Peter's like, "I'm getting out of the boat." You're crazy. Let me tell you something. When you take a step of faith, sometimes the people that are going to be your greatest opponents are the Christians. Try to talk you out of it, to keep you where you're at. So Peter gets out on the boat. He's like, "God, if it's you, Jesus." And Jesus says, he didn't say stay, he says, "Come." And Peter gets out of the boat. I can't wait. I mean, can you imagine just Peter just getting out on the boat? I don't know if he was nervous or if he got a wakeboard at first. I don't know if he gets out there. And it says that he starts walking towards Jesus. Let me tell you something. Peter is not walking on water. He's walking on the Word of God. He's walking on the Word of God. He's working on what Jesus said, "Come." And when you and I take a step of faith, our faith is not in our faith, it's in the object of our faith. And when we take a step of faith, we can walk on God's Word. And His Word has the power to sustain us. His Word has the power to make the impossible possible. So that when you're in a situation and you think, I was just hearing today about somebody, they saw somebody at the park and they were asking Jesus, "Jesus, I want to tell them about you, but I'm all nervous. And so he's riding his bike in the park, and he goes up to this girl that's crying, and he didn't stop. He just drove by. And then he goes back around, and he's like, Jesus, just help me. And so he gets on his, well, he's on his bike, so he didn't get on his bike, because he's on his bike, but he keeps, he ends up driving by her, and he gets down, and he says, do you know where you're going to go when you die? I'm just kidding, saying that. He just said, are you okay? Are you okay? And she said, no. And he just shared with her in that moment. And he's talked about how it was so unbelievable that God actually worked through him to talk to this person. That's what it talks about when you step out in faith, that God will enable you to do what you think is impossible to become possible. Some of you are in the great, challenging physical circumstances, emotional or mental circumstances, but when you and I are trusting God in those moments, God will make those moments that seem impossible possible by hanging on to his word. My dad suffered with Parkinson's disease for 30 years. I was country club, neighborhood like this. We moved 5 times, had no money. I remember in college sitting in the kitchen with my dad and just saying, how could you sit there and tell me you trust God? Look what he's done to our family. He never, ever wavered his faith, ever. He knew God was in control of his life. And I would hear from time to time people talk about, man, your dad, he just blessed me. He just blessed me with how he walked through that. When you and I are willing to be in a situation, say, I'm going to trust what God's word says, God will enable you to do what is impossible. It will become possible in your life. What has God maybe commanded you to do or called you to do right now? And we're still in the boat. It's safe in the boat. It's comfortable in the boat. You know, you're dependent on the boat. The waves are crashing, but at least you're in the boat. When you get out of the boat, you're not dependent on the boat anymore because you're not in the boat. You got to depend on something else. But listen, when God calls you to do something, God will enable you and empower you to do it. Whether you're going through a great, tremendous a struggle, you're experiencing a loss, you're experiencing a lot of change, you're experiencing anxiety, whatever it may be, that God's word makes things possible that seem impossible. Peter will tell you that. I mean, this last point with you this morning. Not only has God's word has the power to make things impossible possible, but let me tell you this last point. Point is you and I, another anchor, this is the third anchor, is that we need to focus on God's promises, not our problems. Hello? We need to focus on God's promises, not his problems. I know it's so much easier said than done. I could sit up here and say, just focus on God's promises, not your problems. I got a lot of problems, okay? And my problems are always bigger than your problems. Right? I got a lot of problems. Right? Now, check this out, okay? Peter is not afraid of the wind. Storm, waves, they're getting beat, a lot of tension. He's not afraid of it. He doesn't get afraid of it until he steps out in faith. It's often when you and I are willing to step out in faith that all of a sudden you start sensing fear. You're sensing opposition and adversity. And what did the wind represent to him? It was the adversity they were facing. So what does he do? When he's walking on water, he starts to take his attention onto the adversity that he's facing and not Jesus. You ever done that before? You're walking along, and all of a sudden you start turning and you start looking at your opposition. Well, maybe what people are talking about you, saying stuff about you, with your kids, your spouse, work. Listen, you can't see the wind, but you can hear it. A lot of the opposition, we don't see it, but we hear it. You're going to fail if you really start walking and following Christ, you know what people are going to say about you? Don't do it. Don't do it. Maybe in your family, you're trying to follow Jesus. Like, okay, Jesus, Mr. Jesus. You're trusting God in the moment. It's an illness or something going on. You're just trusting. You're like, God's with me. It's like, you're like, man, don't be talking about that God stuff. You start hearing all this noise around you. When you and I step out in faith, all of a sudden, if we start looking at the wind, we start getting fearful of that adversity in our life. It's not fearful in the boat. It's not fearful in the boat, but if you're going to step out in faith, let me tell you something, the enemy's going to try to get you afraid. And we got to focus on the Word of God. We got to focus on His promises, not our problems. We got to focus on our God's Word and His promises, not our problems. So if you hear this story before, you probably hear like, oh, Peter failed, right? Oh, you have little faith. And meanwhile, like the Sandlot group is in the boat, right? And just watching this happening, right? And it's interesting because it says that when Peter started to take his attention off of Jesus, off of God's promises and focusing on his problems, he starts to sink. But listen, Jesus reached out his hand to grab him. It tells us that he had gone far enough to get close to Jesus. And maybe some of you need to hear this morning. You have come so far. Don't start focusing on the problems. You've come so far. You've come so far. Keep walking. Keep walking in God's promises. And Jesus catches them, saves them, and they get in the boat, and the storm is over. Class dismissed. Training exercise is over. Isn't that something? Isn't that something? See, Jesus didn't do this in public. Like, he didn't have, like, the 5,000 people going, hey, watch this, guys, you know? This is private. This is personal. See, God will take you through some personal things for you to experience him so that you have experience. And God can use you in that way. Listen, God has a tremendous plan for your life. God has a tremendous plan for this church. Amen. This, any adversity that you're facing, that this church is facing, listen, thank you, Jesus. Man, there was about 2 months ago, or not 2 months, maybe about a month ago, and I was struggling with some stuff one night, and I just was asking, I was praying, God, just give me your word. I want to hear a word from you. And this is the story he led me to. The three anchors that we have in our walk with Jesus when we face adversity is that God will send you this storm on purpose for a purpose. Is that that God's word has the power to make the impossible possible. And the third thing is don't focus on our problems, but focus on the promises of God. If I want to fast forward back to the time when Peter and the disciples are arrested. I wonder if Peter, I don't know, I'm just making, I'll have to ask him when we get to heaven. But if he's in jail, just wonder, man, when was the last time the 5,000 people and I went up in adversity? It's like, oh yeah, oh yeah. See, the history tells us this. They got out of jail and they didn't stop. They graduated from this training exercise. It was impactful. History tells us that they went out in the midst of great adversity, proclaiming the name of Jesus. And to a lot of them, ended up until their death, martyred for their faith. And it was the faithfulness of them through the Spirit of God that you and I are even here this morning. Listen, you have no idea the generational impact of what's going on in your life right now. Generational. of you trusting God in the midst of your adversity right now. Where are you right now? What opportunities are you faced with right now? What adversity maybe you face? And if you're not in the midst of adversity right now, you just came out of it or you're about to go in it. And we're going to, Megan and Oliver are going to sing this song. As we just sing this song this morning, let's just respond to God and thank Him for His grace and thank you for His mercy and thank you for His goodness and thank you for His kindness. What you're going through is not in vain. Is not in vain. Just allow the Spirit of God to speak to you this morning. Whatever it, if there's something that said that God is just speaking to you about, just meet with Him about that. Just respond to Him in that way. Maybe you're here this morning and you feel like this has been a long time. And you felt like that you didn't get it. You didn't understand the adversity thing. You kind of walked away for a little bit. And you say, God, is there another hope? Is there another chance for me? And Jesus is calling you again right now. And maybe you're here this morning and you're in that boat and you know that the opportunity that you have right now, and Jesus says, come on out. Take that step of faith, whatever it is. Let's just take this moment and allow God's Spirit to speak to us and speak to you this morning. Jesus, we love you. We thank you, God. We thank you for how you work in our life, God. I thank you for your presence. We thank you for your power, God. God, please meet with us, Lord. Continue to speak to us.
Great unknown.
some of us need it today, and some of us are just put it in our pocket because we're going to need it in the future. We know that we need God's word. We know that we need God's teaching. We know we need God's people. And that's why we have this wonderful family in our church. And so as we meet each other, I want to invite all of you guys tonight. We have a family meeting tonight. And as God guides us forward as body, we learn from each other, our individual relationships with each other, and how we come together. So hope everyone can make it. It's 6 o'clock tonight, and we'll go from 6 to 8, and we'll be talking about the future of the church and how God's leading us. And then next Saturday is a busy, fun weekend. We've got the ladies' tea from 2 to 4 on Saturday. And today is the last day to sign up, so there are sign-up sheets out in the foyer. So make sure you sign up. I think it's only for ladies, so. you can sign up to babysit. Kids at home. And then after that, on Sunday, next Sunday, if you're new to church or visiting the church, you want to learn more about the church and how we operate and who we are, there will be an introduction to Sienna Ranch Baptist Church meeting after worship on next Sunday. So we invite you to just come and join and learn more about our church and who we are. And then finally, if you're visiting, we have Robin, who will be out at the Connections table. She's the friendliest member of our church, so we put her out there. But she'll have a gift to welcome you and just get your information and see how we can follow up with you to get to know you better. And finally, thank you for continuing to give, for all of you guys who support the ministry of our church, and thanks for all those who continue to volunteer. We need all we can as we work together to glorify God's name. And for those of you who would like to pray after the meeting, you can go over to Eve's Garden. And if you started, we'll need people come together to pray either for you and also for the church. So thanks and have a great week.
It's so much joy, and then I don't want to leave.